Good morning, everyone. A very warm welcome to you this morning to Dale St. Andrews Parish Church. Thank you for joining us for our service of worship. After the service this morning in the hall, there's a lunch provided for those who would like to come through and share in that. The cost is £3 for adults and £1.50 for young people. And the proceeds from that are going to be going to the ongoing upgrade of our audiovisual system, particularly in relation to the pilot year that we hope to begin in around Easter in providing a service for people who are deaf and hearing impaired. So if you join us for that, it's probably good to know that that's what the proceeds are going to. Not this week, but next week, there will be a table provided by Christine Scott. She's got various new cards and crafts that she's producing. And Christine very kindly produced 250 bookmarks, Dale St. Andrews bookmarks, for us last Sunday. And these were all given away, so I don't think there were any left. She hopes to have some available to those who maybe didn't get one last week. The idea was to take them and to use them as an invitation to people to come along and to join us in worship on a Sunday. So if you didn't get one last week, you'd like to get one, then if you go through to the table next Sunday after the service, you can have a look at Christine's cards and crafts and you can pick up a bookmark then as well. We were sad to hear the news this week of the death of Irene Rankin, who was on our congregational roll. Her funeral will be held in Holytown Crematorium on Thursday this week at 10:30. I will be conducting that. And if you knew Irene, you're welcome to come and pay your respects. Please remember her husband, Jim, and their daughter, Gillian, in your prayers this week, if you would. On Thursday also in the evening, there's a special performance of a play which has come from the Edinburgh Fringe, and it's called The God Particle. It's a conversation on the theme of science and faith. There's a charge of £3 payable at the door if you'd like to come along and share in that. It got really good reviews when it was through in Edinburgh, and if you are interested in that kind of theme, then I'm sure that you would very much enjoy it. It starts at 7:30, but the doors will be open about 7 o'clock that evening. So come along and support that if you're free to do so. All the other news items are on the sheet and were on the screens as you were arriving also. We hope that you take note and are able to come along to some of the things that are on over the next few weeks. Let's kneel in the darkness until we see God's light. Let us wait with hope-filled hearts as Christ's image grows within us. Let him speak to us and teach us about love on this day that the world pays attention to that subject, until we open our hearts fully and he comes and makes his home within us. Let's worship God in our opening hymn. It's from the Mission Praise Book, but the words will appear on the screen, and some of you will have these in sheets. It's one of the more modern songs, King of Kings, Majesty, God of Heaven, living in me.
Oh,
What a beautiful song, and what a thought. Not the clothes that we're wearing, but spiritually, what we're adorned in is all the beauty and the splendor that God grants to us in Christ, rather than the filthy rags that we create for ourselves through our disobedience and our sin. Let's draw near to God in prayer now. Let us pray. King, Majesty, God, Saviour, Friend, Deliverer, the very embodiment and essence of love. All of these are ways in which we speak and sing of you, Heavenly Father. Yet not one, nor even all put together, comes close to describing how we feel about you. Nor do these titles and names sum up all that you are in your being, or indeed all that you do for each one of us. You are our Lord. You are the Holy One. You are the mighty God over all. And we bring to you this morning the worship that you deserve. And we lay our lives before you once more. We sing and we pray with faltering lips because we know that you know the many ways in which we disappoint you and even fail to come up to our own standards. Wondrous God, we confess that we have not listened for your word as we should. We have placed obstacles in the way of others, and we are guilty of pride and arrogance. And so we ask that you will forgive our foolish and hateful ways. Forgive us also when we take you for granted, and redirect us by your Holy Spirit, that we may be your faithful people once again. We've gathered here, loving God, to meet with you and to journey towards the cross. We've gathered here to repent of our sins, publicly and privately. Guide us as we journey deeper into your embrace of love and forgiveness, and as we kneel before the cross of Christ, may we put to death those things that separate us from each other and from you. May we know your presence with us now and always. May we know the power of your transforming love in our hearts and your glorious grace which surrounds and upholds us. In the name of Jesus, who is our companion on this journey of faith, we bring to you our prayers and sum up all that we are feeling and thinking in the words which he himself taught his first followers to say. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now we turn to praise God again, this time from church hymnary number 4. 466 is the number there. Before the throne of God above, I have a strong, a perfect plea, a great high priest whose name is love, who ever lives and pleads for me.
I'm not sure. Good morning, everyone. Morning, Eric. Today is the first Sunday of a period in the church's calendar called Lent. Lent started last Wednesday with Ash Wednesday, and for those of you who maybe had an abundance of pancakes last Tuesday, you would know this, that Lent has started. And Lent is a period of time in the church year where we are invited to journey with Jesus through the scriptures toward Easter week, Palm Sunday, the crucifixion, the resurrection, and so on. And I share that with you because, in a sense, we as a congregation over the next few weeks will be making that journey to the cross and to the death of Jesus Christ, because we're starting a new section in the Essential Jesus series, a section which will take us through that story of Jesus being led to his death upon the cross. 2 weeks ago, Derek took us through the passage of the prayer in Gethsemane, and today's scripture reading immediately follows that. It's Matthew chapter 26, and it's verses 47 through to 56. So immediately after the prayer in the Garden of Gethsemane, we read, "While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. With him was a large crowd armed with swords and clubs sent from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had arranged a signal with them. 'The one I kiss is the man. Arrest him.' Going at once to Jesus, Judas said, 'Greetings, Rabbi,' and kissed him. Jesus replied, 'Do what you came for, friend.' Then the men stepped forward, seized Jesus, and arrested him. With that, one of Jesus' companions reached for his sword, drew it out, and struck the servant of the high priest, cutting off his ear. 'Put your sword back in its place,' Jesus said to him, 'for all who draw the sword will die by the sword. Do you not think I cannot call on my Father, and he will at once put at my disposal more than 12 legions of angels? But how then would the scriptures be fulfilled that say it must happen in this way?' In that hour, Jesus said to the crowd, 'Am I leading a rebellion that you have come out with swords and clubs to capture me? Every day I sat in the temple courts teaching, and you did not arrest me. But this has all taken place that the writings of the prophets may be fulfilled.' Then all the disciples deserted him and fled." Amen. And may God bless to us the reading of his holy word this day. We continue to worship God as we come to reflect on that passage. It's in the church hymnary number 559. "There is a Redeemer, Jesus, God's own Son." Let us stand and sing together.
Jesus, God's own Son.
I imagine most of you will be familiar with the expression fight or flight. And it's the idea that when we are presented with some sort of danger, there's two ways that we as people can respond. We either respond to that danger by fighting, meeting that danger head on, or we respond by running away, by fleeing, by getting away from whatever is causing us fear or anxiety. I imagine as well that when we are in these situations, our reactions are much more complex, but basically some would suggest that how we react when we meet a danger or a threat, broadly speaking, fits into those two categories. Now, when I read a story, I sometimes get a bit of an active imagination. And I like to imagine myself in that story. I like to imagine, what would Stuart Love have done if he was in the circumstances described in this particular story, whatever it is that I'm reading? And this can be true of the Bible stories too. When I read my Bible and I read about the amazing things that maybe Jesus did or the amazing things that happened in some of the biblical stories, I like to imagine and think, what would I have done if I'd been there? How would I have reacted? What's the sort of thing that would have been going on for me had I been present and actually been witnessing these things firsthand? And needless to say, I try and imagine myself in the best light. I'd have been the hero of the story. I'd have been the one that, you know, stepped forward and was able to do whatever was asked of me. And so when I read this story from Matthew's Gospel, the story of Jesus' arrest, part of me would like to think that perhaps I would come out looking fairly well. But another part of me thinks that's probably not true. And I would have reacted no differently than some of the disciples in this story. As we read Matthew 26 together, and certainly as I read it over the course of the week in preparation for today, the question that came to my mind was, which disciple are you in this story? As you read it and as you maybe do what I do and try and imagine yourself in this story, which disciple are you? There are three possibilities today. You are either the disciple who betrayed, you're the disciple who fought, or you're the disciples who flew and who ran. And so that's where I got this notion for the fight or flight analogy. Because in this story, you either betray, you fight, or you run. Let's explore these and see if we can see ourselves in this story. The first disciple is the one that betrayed, Judas. Judas Iscariot, one of the 12. One of the disciples who had been in Jesus' inner circle. One of the disciples who had traveled with Jesus, had seen the miracles, had heard the good news of the gospel being proclaimed. Judas had been there all along, hearing what Jesus was doing, seeing what Jesus was doing. And in spite of all that, he was the one who betrayed him, who handed him over to those who wanted to kill him. And that, I think, should give us in the church today pause for thought. Because if we are attending worship, if we're listening to the Bible being read, if we're singing the hymns, if we're doing all the right things, but we're not actually letting these things sink to affect us in our hearts, to change who we are as people, then we are no better than Judas. You see, the problem that Judas had was that Jesus didn't fit his idea of what the Savior was supposed to be. He wanted Jesus to be this sort of revolutionary figure who would come and would restore Israel to its political power, or at least that's what some people think. And so the problem that Judas had was that he was trying to fit Jesus into his agenda rather than allowing Jesus' agenda to change him to become the person that God wanted him to be. And so in spite of the fact that Judas was part of Jesus' inner circle, because he did not allow that to change who he was as a person, he betrayed Jesus. He betrayed Jesus into the hands of his enemies. I don't know about you, but, you know, we maybe are quite hard on Judas for that reason. We think, oh, how could he possibly have done this considering he was one of the 12? But listen to what Jesus says to Judas. Verse 50, Jesus replied, "Do what you came for, friend." Despite the fact that Judas was handing Jesus over to be put to death, Jesus called him friend. And so there's a sense that what I want to share with you from that this morning is that even if you relate to Judas in this story, I hope you don't, but if you do relate to Judas in this story, if you see yourself as someone who maybe goes through the motions but doesn't allow the message of Jesus to sink into your heart, then that doesn't mean that Jesus cannot call you friend, because he does. Jesus called Judas friend. And so in the same way, he is calling you friend and inviting you to actually allow his message to penetrate deeper, to change who you are, to become the person that God wants you to be, rather than the person that you want to be. The disciple who betrayed was called friend. Then we have the disciple who fought as Jesus is being arrested. There's a disciple who has come armed. He's come with a sword, and he draws that sword, and he lashes out at the nearest person, and that happens to be the high priest's servant. In Matthew's account, the ear of the servant is cut off. In other Gospels, we read that Jesus actually healed this servant who lost his ear. But look at the way that Jesus responds to the person who drew the sword. He says, "Put your sword back in its place, for all who draw the sword will die by the sword." We might sympathize with this disciple because in a sense, he's just defending Jesus. He sees Jesus being arrested and he thinks, well, no one else is doing anything about it. I've got to do something. I know. I'll jump in and defend him. I'll stand up for Jesus. I'll protect him from those that are going to take him away. But Jesus says, no. It's not your place to do this at this time. Jesus goes on. He says an incredible thing. "Do you not think I cannot call on my Father and he will at once put at my disposal more than 12 legions of angels?" What a put down from Jesus. "You don't need to defend me by the sword," he says, "because if I really needed to, I could summon the armies of heaven to come to my aid." But that's not what Jesus wanted, and that's not what Jesus allowed to happen. It's important for us, I think, to realize that there is no biblical precedent for us as Christians to evangelize, to share our faith at sword point. Historically, that has happened. Historically, as the British Empire expanded and as other Christian empires expanded into places like Africa, Asia, and whatever, the Christian faith spread, but it was very much at the point of the sword. Convert or die. Now, I'm sure with recent events that have happened, we know other contexts today where the phrase convert or die is being used. But unlike other religions who can perhaps interpret the instructions of their faith to permit such behavior. There is nothing like that in the Christian faith. Nothing at all that allows us to violently or aggressively try to convert people. We are encouraged to fight the good fight, but the way that we fight the good fight is so important. We are not to evangelize by the sword. The way that we share our faith with other people is important, and the way that we do share our faith is often by living it out, by showing people what it is like to live as a Christian, to live as a follower of Jesus Christ. We cannot force people into God's kingdom as much as we'd want to. I met up with some very good friends yesterday in Edinburgh. None of them are Christians. I would love them, love for them to come to faith. But I can't force them to. What I do is I hope and pray that as I continue to be their friends, as I continue to meet with them for lunch, for dinner, for social events, whatever, that something of my faith shines through to them. And that one day they say, do you know what, Stuart? Something about you is different, and I would like that too. And that is how we can share our faith. So maybe you relate to the disciple who fought in this story. And if that's the case, well, maybe you need to rethink how it is you share your faith. Maybe you need to rethink and make sure that you share your faith in a way that does reflect the love and the grace of Jesus Christ, rather than trying to force people into God's kingdom. And finally, we have all the disciples who ran, who flew. And as I said a few minutes ago, as much as I would like to think of myself in these stories as being the hero who stood by Jesus through thick and thin, who didn't pick up a sword, but who went quite happily to be arrested with him, I think it's actually far more likely that I'd be one of these disciples. I'd be one of the disciples that, when Jesus was arrested, thought, oof, I'm getting out of here. This is well above my pay grade. You see, like Judas, all of the disciples had been with Jesus. They had heard the stories that he told, the parables. They'd seen the miracles. They knew all the things that he had announced about the good news of the kingdom of God. And yet, when it really came down to it, when there was an opportunity for them to show their devotion and their loyalty to their master, they ran. They ran away. Later in the story, we do read about one or two disciples who did stay, but not for very long. And actually, if I am getting a bit ahead of myself here, but if we even go ahead to the story of the crucifixion, the disciples that did stay with Jesus right through to that point were the women. And it was the men, the 12, who scarpered. I share that with you simply to say that people who think that the Christian faith doesn't advocate equality clearly don't know their Bible. Because in a patriarchal society, a society where men were on top, the notion that the men ran away would be rather dishonorable for them. But what an advert it is for the women who stayed loyal to Jesus right to the end. Maybe you identify with these disciples, as I say, I think I certainly do. Because sometimes we have opportunities to share our faith with other people, and rather than take those opportunities, we too run away. There are points in life when we have a chance to say to someone, this is the love of God. This is the faith that I have in Jesus Christ. But for whatever reason, instead of taking that step and sharing our faith, what we do instead is we bite our tongue and we look for an opportunity to either change the conversation or we just get out of there, like the disciples. And don't get me wrong, sharing faith can be difficult at times, especially in this day and age when, generally speaking, those of us with faith are being looked down on in society. Those of us who have a faith are more marginalized than we perhaps would have been just a few decades ago. But that doesn't mean that we stop sharing our faith, because we as Christians, whether we like it or not, are called to share the faith of Jesus Christ with other people. And there are ways to do that. I've already said that one way to share the gospel is to actually live it out. Just let people see how God has changed you. And that may be the way in for them to say to God, I would like that as well. Another thing you might do, I think this is a very powerful thing, and we've lost this a bit. We live in a society which, by and large, has been shaped by the importance of facts and science and being able to prove things, and what we've lost is the importance of stories. I often, when I'm talking about the Bible, will talk about stories. Not because they're made up, because they're true stories, but stories that tell us something. Stories that paint a picture of how things are. And so when it comes to sharing your faith, just tell your story. Tell people about how God has changed you in your life. And the thing is, because it's your story, nobody has the right to tell you that it's wrong. Because it's your story. Their story may be different from your story, but that doesn't make either one more right or more wrong than the other, because it's yours. We all, if we have come to faith in Jesus Christ, have a story to tell about how God has been at work in our lives, and I want to encourage you to share your stories with people. But no matter how hard we try, no matter which disciple it is we relate to, whether it be Judas or the one who fought or the ones who flew, we will let God down. We won't always share our faith when we need to. And so what do we do in those situations? What do we do when, despite all of our efforts, we still let God down? I'm jumping ahead of myself again, and I apologize for that, but there is an important end to the story of Jesus and his disciples. Judas betrayed Jesus, and yet Jesus still called him friend. The disciples fled and abandoned Jesus, but he did not let that damage the relationship he had with them. A few days after Jesus' death, he appeared to his disciples. He said to them, "Peace be with you." They were frightened. They thought they had seen a ghost. But he said, "Why are you troubled, and why do you have doubts rising in your minds? Look at my hands and feet. It is I myself. Touch and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones as you see I have." Jesus came back to his disciples, even although they ran, even although they abandoned him. Jesus came back and said, "Peace be with you. Here I am. I'm back with you." So if you this morning are struggling with feelings that you have perhaps let God down, or that you are convicted by relating to one of the disciples in this story, can I encourage you that Jesus is still coming to you and saying, "Peace be with you. Here I am." The forgiveness and grace of God extend so far, my friends. And we have an opportunity to take hold of that when we say to God, "Yes, I have let you down, and I'm sorry." But he's there. He's saying, "Peace be with you." He's calling you friend. But what's also important is that at the conclusion of that story, where Jesus reappears to the disciples, he says, "Peace be with you," and then he goes on to remind the disciples that they are called to go and share their faith with other people. So we are called to the same We are called friend. Jesus comes to us even though we let him down, but then he reminds us and says, go and tell other people. Go and tell others about what I have done for you and how you have found forgiveness in me. All these disciples let Jesus down in one fashion or another, either through betrayal, through fighting, or through fleeing. And yet, despite this, Jesus was still able to forgive them, to call them friend, and even call them to go out and to share the gospel with other people. This morning, whichever type of disciple you have related to, can I encourage you to turn to Jesus, to receive his forgiveness, to be called his friend. And being called a friend of Jesus, go into the world with his power and his wisdom to share his friendship with others, that they too may come to know the wonderful forgiveness and grace that we can find with God through Jesus Christ. And so what will you do now? Will you betray? Will you fight? Will you fly? Or will you tell others about what Jesus has done for you? Amen. And may God add his blessing to the reading of his word and the preaching of his word today. We continue to worship God, this time by bringing our offerings to him. And as we do that, the choir are going to sing for us.
Thank you.
Let us come to God in prayer once more to give thanks for the offering and to dedicate it to God's service, and also to pray for a couple of situations in our world. So let us pray together. Loving God, we want to give thanks for this offering which has been received today. We thank you that we can contribute to your work in this congregation and in others by giving. We pray, Lord, that you would bless what has been received today, and that you would guide us, and you would give us wisdom to know how we can use what has been taken today, not for our own good, but for the good of other people. We pray you would help us to use all the resources we have in this congregation to share the good news of Jesus Christ with all others. Heavenly Father, we pray for our world this day. We pray especially for the increased tensions and conflicts between countries. It was only yesterday, Lord, that it was declared that tensions have risen so high that they are being compared to the Cold War of the latter 20th century. Lord God, this is not something that we want. We do not want to be in conflict with other people. We do not want to see wars ravaging our world. We want peace. We want to be able to live in a world where peace exists between nations and between people. And so we ask and pray, Lord, that in these situations where conflict is becoming worse, that you would make sure that peace is on the agenda, that world leaders would see sense and see wisdom and would strive for peace in our time. We pray for our own country, Lord, and for some of the inequalities and issues that we are being faced with on a daily basis. We want to pray especially today, Lord, for those medical personnel who have reached a point where they feel they need to strike in order to have a fairer deal in their work. We're grateful that this has not directly affected NHS Scotland, but we want to recognise in prayer, Lord, the importance of groups like the NHS, which provide medical care for all people, regardless of their place in society. We're so grateful that we have these provisions in our country, especially when we look at other countries where there is no such provision. And so we pray for those who are trying their best, Lord, to make organizations like the NHS work. We pray for the staff as well, and we ask, Lord, that again there would be wisdom and sense, and that a fair deal would be struck which allows those working for the NHS to feel valued and feel as though their work is not being taken for granted, but also that continues to provide medical assistance for all who would need it. Lord God, in a moment of silence, we bring before you our own personal prayers for others this day. Almighty God, we pray for the church and for ourselves as we are called to stand up and share our faith in Jesus Christ. May we be emboldened and given wisdom to know how and when to share our faith with other people. Lord, we share our faith because we want people to know the peace and comfort which faith brings, and so we ask that you would help us in this task, and that we would know how to reach other people and bring them to faith in you. We lift these and all our prayers to you now and pray them in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We're going to be joined by the children from Fusion and the Sunday School now to hear a bit about what they've been up to this morning.
Good morning, boys and girls. I noticed in your way in, two things I noticed this morning. Still after yesterday's result at Firth Park, we've got a couple of true believers here. Obviously, men of prayer. And the other thing I noticed, which if you're towards the back, you wouldn't have seen or necessarily heard, as Eric was playing that lovely, well-known, what's called a children's hymn, but I think it's for all of us. A few of the children at the front were mouthing the words and singing, "Yes, Jesus loves me." So that was absolutely delightful. Well done, you. That's what you call a true believer. Boys and girls, I've told you the story in the past. This don't seem to be working, Colin. So you might like to just hit it. I've told you the story in the past of how, when I was a wee boy, just preparing to go to school, I broke my arm. Now, you'll gather that at that time, they didn't have pink plaster casts. I was very thankful of that. I just got a white one. But all of my friends wrote all over it. Has anybody here had, any of the boys and girls in Sunday school or in Fusion, had an arm or a leg or something like that broken? Have you? Did your friends write over the cast? They didn't. Were they? They were forbidden from doing that, were they? Right. Well, one of the other things that I got when I was a wee one was the next slide. If somebody would advance it for me, please. And that was the measles. Now, that's something that kiddies these days tend not to get, but I know that a few of you have had chicken pox recently, haven't you? And it's not very nice because you end up with spots in your face. It's not very pleasant at all. And that wasn't very pleasant for me. And then the other thing that I had when I was a wee one was the next slide. Because my eyes were not very good when I was a wee boy and remain so, although that's as much to do with old age as it is anything now, I had at one point to wear a wee patch on one of my eyes to try and help make my eye feel better. But they didn't get anything as nice as that when I was a wee boy. Look, that's a wee monkey on that patch. Can you see that? And some of you who wear spectacles have got beautiful spectacles now compared with, I had black National Health spectacles. The only option apart from black was pink. So it was bad enough having to wear spectacles. I certainly wasn't going to wear pink ones. My spectacles always ended up broken also, boys and girls, because I was forever playing football. Oh, that's great. I can't see a thing now. I've taken these off. And every time I played football, I always get the ball on the face and always snapped the bit in the middle. So my spectacles never looked as good as this because they always had a bit of plaster and elastoplast holding them together so that they would sit on my face. And quite a few of my school photographs are like that. with these black specks. So that, combined with my red hair and being taller than everyone, really singled me out from the crowd. I don't have black specs anymore. I've got quite nice ones now, because you get to choose nice spectacles now, don't you? And it's lovely to see the children wearing nice spectacles. But very often, if there was something wrong with me then and still now, you might end up going to see a doctor, either at your local surgery here in Motherwell or wherever you stay, or you might end up at the hospital. But in Jesus' day, you couldn't just look up a doctor very, very easily. And you certainly couldn't go to a hospital easily at all. So what ended up happening was something like what happened in the story that you were learning about today. And the person that was sick got sicker and sicker and sicker. And sometimes they even died, which is terribly sad. And in the story today, there was someone who was sick. Who can tell me who was sick in the story today? Kayla? It was a wee boy. It was. That was a really quite a good Scottish accent there, wasn't it? It was a wee boy that was sick. And somebody came to Jesus to ask him to help, because they were really worried about the wee boy. Who was that, Adam? Who came to Jesus to tell him about the wee boy? His dad, the wee boy's dad, came to Jesus to ask him to help. And Jesus didn't actually go with the man to help the wee boy. He said to him, "Go, your son will be fine." So the father thought this was a bit odd, but off he went anyway, and he trusted that Jesus was going to make him better. Can we have our next slide, please? Can you see? That's a couple of plasters, but they're in the shape of a cross, and underneath it says, "Jesus heals." And by the time the man got home, one of the folk from his house came running to tell him that the wee boy was made well. And when he asked what time it was that the wee boy got well, he told him, my next slide, it was 1 o'clock. Now that was an amazing thing, because the wee boy got well at 1 o'clock, and that was exactly the time that Jesus told the father of the wee boy, "Go home, your son is going to be fine." Isn't that an amazing thing? Jesus didn't even have to go and pray with the wee boy or be with him. And the man just trusted what Jesus said. And the wee boy ended up well. He ended up healed. So it's great to go to doctors and to nurses, but it's also sometimes important that we pray and we ask God to help us, either when we're sick or when we're worried about something. Now, I thought today that instead of finishing my time with you with a wee prayer, I thought we would finish with a wee song. How do you fancy that? So there should be some words of a song up here just in a moment, I hope. Jesus' love is very wonderful. Now, I think some of you were singing this amongst the very young children just a couple of weeks ago, and I asked Eric if he would play it for me, but there are some actions to this as well. And I'm doing this morning because one or two of the folks said that they kind of missed some of these fun wee songs with the children. So I thought, well, let's do one this morning because it fits in really well with the story. We sing, "Jesus' love is very wonderful." Okay? "Jesus' love is very wonderful. Jesus' love is very wonderful." And then the next bit goes on to, "It's so high." Have we got that? "You can't get over it." So you reach up as high as you can get. "It's so low, you can't get under it. It's so wide, you can't get around it. Oh, wonderful love." So do you think we can stand up and we'll give it a go? And the adults will join us. Come on, adults. Let's sing this together. Eric will start us off and we'll just sing it through once together, shall we? You ready? Here we go. One more time? Would that be okay? Great. Let's do it one more time then, shall we? That's fantastic. You did a really good job of that. You're singing super, and you did all the actions as well, so well done. And that's a nice story. We're doing these stories, and the theme is all about how Jesus helps people, how Jesus cares for people. And that song and that story today help us to remember how Jesus cares for all of us. Now, we're going to finish with another song, and the adults are going to join in as well. It's number 467 out of the church hymnary, All My Days I Will Sing This Song of Gladness, Give My Praise to the Fountain of Delights. Those who live in the shelter of the Most High will find rest in the shadow of the Almighty. He will shield you with his wings. He will shelter you with his feathers. His faithful promises are your armor and your protection. And so go from here with peace and joy to love and to serve the Lord, now and always.